Today we are going to preview OU versus Texas Part Doe. And all that's coming up after the bumper.
What do you mean you don't subscribe to my son's YouTube channel?
Mama, no!
Just snap the damn ball, RJ.
What's up, kinfolk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step mill. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. It's always OU related, college football related, sports related. We have a good time. And today, we are going to preview Oklahoma versus Texas for the belt, for the Big 12 title. And this is a historic rematch. Why? Because the last time that this happened where OU and Texas played twice in the same year, yo man, Oklahoma wasn't even a state yet. Oklahoma and Texas tied the first time in 1903, and then Texas won the rematch 11-5. I'm sure there's a lot of Texas fans who think that's probably a possibility, them winning the rematch. But before we get into the nuts and bolts of that, two things. For Oklahoma, your path is clear to the college football playoff, okay? And it begins and ends with a win in the Big 12 title game. So not only is Oklahoma having to play for a Big 12 championship to gain entry into the college football playoff, they would have to do it in a way that nobody else has had to do it, which is win four straight conference titles. So Oklahoma is playing for history and a chance at a national title. Even so, there's a good argument for Ohio State perhaps being that fourth team in with a big win against Michigan on Saturday. Now, I think that the math works out to where if you check the resumes and both of those teams win their conference titles, that loss against Purdue is like seeing your grandmother naked. You just can't unsee it, man. And if you're Oklahoma, your only loss was to a top 15 Texas team that you would have beaten in a rematch, as well as a top 15 win over a really good West Virginia team. And everybody knows what the offense is capable of and what Lincoln Riley has done as the head coach at OU. The next thing I want to point your attention to is this fallacy about Oklahoma's defense being torched in every single game. It's just simply not true. We know this because we keep score in this game called college football. And Oklahoma held Florida Atlantic to 14 points total in the season opener. Held Kansas State to 14 points total after Mike Stoops was fired. And gave up 20 points as a defense to TCU. Now, in recent weeks, the month of November really, Oklahoma's defense has been flayed, particularly the secondary. And I wrote a piece about Buki in the secondary on OUinsider.com, probably going to make an upload about it. But that's also what Oklahoma is up against when you're talking about resumes and whether or not it should be Ohio State or Oklahoma who gets that fourth college football playoff spot, in that the defense at Oklahoma just ain't very good. Defense at Ohio State ain't much better. The offenses, both of those teams can score, and you have Heisman candidates in Dwayne Haskins at quarterback for Ohio State and Kyler Murray at quarterback for Oklahoma. Now, all of this does not take into account Georgia perhaps beating Alabama. Now, I don't think that Alabama's going to lose to Georgia, but you got to know that Georgia fans would love to beat Alabama, not just because it would get them an SEC title game, not just because it's Alabama, but because that would probably get them into the college football playoff, because with that win on their resume and one loss, that makes them a much better candidate for the four spot than Oklahoma or Ohio State, because there's no better win in college football than taking down number one. And also, this would give Georgia fans an opportunity to put their finger in OU fans' eyes once again, and that's not something that you want. So, for the OU-Texas game, I look at it from strengths and weaknesses. Now, we know that a strength of Oklahoma is obviously Kyler Murray. As I say, we have Kyler Murray and you don't. And that was on full display against West Virginia, where he had over 480 yards of offense himself, and he made two crucial back-to-back games to win it for Oklahoma late. Had a pass to CeeDee Lamb that he caught off the turf, which was great. And then Kyler Murray did it himself to secure the first down, for which Oklahoma could run out the clock and get a three-point victory over the Mountaineers in Morgantown. But Kyler Murray is not just any X-factor. He is the X-factor. The guy is going after being a 4,000-yard passer and a 1,000-yard rusher. He's averaging 300 yards passing and 60 yards rushing a game. Nobody's ever done that in the sport. And statistically speaking, there's nothing like him. There's never been anything like him. There might not ever be anything like him ever again, except there's this guy named Tua Tagovailoa, who's second in most categories, but also putting up some insane numbers. Kyler Murray torched Texas, more to the point. In the neutral field game, Kyler Murray scored 21 points in 6 minutes with one of those long runs that he reeled off against West Virginia. And I don't know that anybody, let alone Texas, has an answer for that kind of play from Kyler Murray, especially if he can get another receiving day like he got out of Hollywood Brown against West Virginia. Nearly 250 yards receiving, 11 catches, huge day for him. And you got this guy named Kennedy Brooks in the backfield who has carried the ball all of 103 times and is 7 yards from a 1,000-yard season. He's averaging 9.6 yards per rush. However, we also know that with the backfield of Oklahoma, you're real slim. Kennedy Brooks, Trey Sermon, TJ Pledger, those are your scholarship backs at best if they're healthy. And we're not sure about TJ Pledger. Trey Sermon could go, but it's clear that Kennedy Brooks was getting bulk of the carries and should, because he's the dominant number one on the depth chart right now. You also got plenty of X factors at the wide receiver positions in guys like Lee Morris and Grant Calcaterra. If you want to throw Nick Basqueen, Miles Tease in there, you can. But the other major strength for Oklahoma is the offensive line. Oklahoma's offensive line has been great since Bill Beedenbaugh took over as the offensive line coach, and he was a Broyles Award semifinalist heading into the game against West Virginia, and you saw why. If you watched the broadcast, you saw that Holly Rowe stalked Creed Humphrey for a while. She also watched the offensive line, and she believes what most folks believe: this is the best offensive line in the country, with a redshirt freshman in Creed Humphrey, who most folks in the program believe is the most talented guy on the roster. That includes Kyler Murray. You also have some vets and NFL prospects at guard in Ben Powers, at guard in Drew Samia, Cody Ford at right tackle, and Bobby Evans at left tackle. This line has managed to stay healthy for the most part, and that's also been a really big deal. Can't undersell that. But you can run the ball almost whenever you want with this offensive line. And they do a good job of keeping Kyler Murray clean, even though it's Kyler Murray and you know that he's going to make things happen as a quarterback in that position, because that's just what he does. But you cannot undersell how big it is for Oklahoma to have an edge at offensive line, specifically when you start to talk about the strengths of Texas. One strength of Texas is their defense. Todd Orlando has those boys playing well, and it starts for them like it starts for most defenses up front. They are able to play a three-man line and play it well because their safeties are really good and their linebackers can make tackles. But even just looking at the defensive line, Charles Omenihu and Brecken Hager, they're the real deal at defensive end. They talk a lot of noise, also makes this rivalry really cool, but they have a future in the NFL. Gary Johnson, if he plays against Oklahoma, and I don't know why he wouldn't, is their best tackler at linebacker. And then when you look at the defensive backs, you got a guy in Chris Boyd who's going to play on Saturdays at corner. You have an awesome freshman at safety in Caden Stearns. And you got two more defensive backs that you like a lot in Brandon Jones and PJ Locke. The defense is stout, but it's also a defense that knows that Oklahoma dropped 45 on them. And if you can drop 45 on them, yeah, you'd be pretty good. Same thing could be said about the number one pass defense in America, which was Michigan, for which Dwayne Haskins torched for 62 points. Jim Harbaugh makes a lot of money to lose to Ohio State every year. Another strength of Texas is LJ Humphrey and Colin Johnson at wide receiver. Two trees for which Oklahoma does not have an answer for. It's not just that Oklahoma is bad in the secondary. It's that LJ Humphrey and Colin Johnson are real good at being big and tall and catching passes. LJ Humphrey is a 1,000-yard receiver. He's got over 70 catches this year. Colin Johnson is closing in on 800 yards receiving. He's got over 50 catches this year. Both of those guys were sunning Oklahoma's defensive backs, particularly Parnell Motley and Trey Brown. You could see guys trying to fight through it with them. But the fact of the matter is, I expect Tom Herman to exploit LJ Humphrey and Colin Johnson against Oklahoma's defensive backs, because That's a win every time you want to put the ball there, unless Oklahoma can find a way to get the ball out of their hands or get in front of the ball. But as those wide receivers are just being power forwards and boxing folks out and going to get balls and then just knocking them down, I don't really see a way for Oklahoma to win that except to stop the run early. When Sam Ehlinger tucks the ball and run, you got to hit him. You got to put him on the ground. You have to get pressure. It'd be good for Oklahoma to blitz more, but they seem to bring that sooner blitz, which is four-man rush, because three-man rushes at Oklahoma just ain't working, because, I mean, we get it personnel, and that's beside the point. And we'll talk about that, I'm sure, a lot in the offseason. But the fact is, you got to get pressure on Sam Ehlinger. You have to stop Trey Watson and Keontae Ingram in the backfield. But mostly, it's those wide receivers. That's the edge for Texas as an offense, and really Texas as a team. Now, the other edge we have to speak about is that Texas has a W. Mentally, they got an edge. They know that they won the game. Now, if you're OU, you also know you won this game with an entirely different defense coordinator. I know folks don't like Ruffin McNeil. I know that it feels like you haven't really made any steps forward. It feels like you're taking some steps back at times. But it is a different defense, and I'm sure that they'll have different looks. And you'll have a different attitude from the players. Let's not forget that one of the reasons Mike was fired was because he lost the room. He lost the players. Ruffin McNeil has not. And that speaks volumes for him as a coach. And I believe it's one of the reasons for which you get hard play. And when you get hard play, you get things like the scoop and score and the strip sacks that you got against West Virginia. Those things could be huge against Texas. And particularly with an offense like Oklahoma that averages about 600 yards a game. But the other thing that makes this particular Big 12 title game awesome is the trash talk. Tom Herman does not like Oklahoma. Oklahoma does not like Tom Herman. We got all this talk about horns down and horns up and who's mad at who and who remembers what and the tweets flying and Tom Herman's association with Zach Smith and Urban Meyer at Ohio State and Ohio State being in the hunt for college football playoff. There is so much noise around this game that that's one of the reasons that it's amazing to be a fan of either one of those teams and to be able to settle this once and for all in 2018 in the game that matters. It's for the belt. It is for the belt. And for Oklahoma, it's for the belt, it's for the playoff, and it's for history. And I, for one, am so excited about it. Right? That's it for me. Deuces.